Good morning, everybody. All right. So can we go back to slide 5 for a second? I think it was slide 5. All right, so I have an offer for the two researchers who stood up. I would love to talk to you about that. Okay, as a former audit partner who spent 20 years serving public company audit clients, these are very important topics, very important topics. And I'm sure my counterparts in the other firms would love to talk to you as well, because you're on to two important issues. So just to make real life the work that you do, this is really important. So as you conduct that research, please don't hesitate to reach out to me and my counterparts as well, because you're on the right topics. So with that, we don't need that slide anymore. So Sunday morning in New York at the Waldorf. So we all have, everybody in this room, come from different places, different backgrounds, but we have a few things in common. The first thing is we all have a passion for this profession. We wouldn't have dedicated our careers to this profession, and we wouldn't dedicate our time on a Sunday in August in New York City if we didn't care about this profession. We also all influence the lives of young students and young employees who come to work for our firms or you train at your colleges and universities, either directly or indirectly through your research. And lastly, the auditing profession has been good to every single one of us, both in terms of experiences, places in the world that it's taken us that we never dreamed of, economically, and more importantly than anything, the ability to influence society, the ability to make a difference. So despite whatever differences we have, there's incredible common ground that we all have. And what we want to do today is we want to cover three very important topics, and what I would say in substance, get to some of the heart of the issues and the opportunities that are out there around three important topics. The first topic that Cindy referred to is we want to talk about talent. I'll come back to that in a second as I introduce that topic. But we'll spend about 90 minutes this morning going into early afternoon talking about talent. And I have my own views on that that I'll share in a second. The next topic that we talk about is we'll talk about internal controls or financial reporting. And we'll have a panel that talks about it. I do want to give a couple of words about internal controls. When Sarbanes-Oxley came out, after we had the Enron, WorldCom, MCI crisis, when that came out, what the world said is that this profession matters and we want your point of view around internal controls. That's really important. What the world told us is that you're relevant beyond the simple set of financial statements. Now, were all the rules well understood at that point in time? Had they evolved over time? Absolutely. But we can't lose sight of the big picture that our stakeholders said the auditing profession's point of view on internal controls matters. And as we think about how this evolves, now that we're over a decade old of dealing with internal controls, it's important for us to make sure we understand that the profession is relevant. That stakeholders want our point of view, not just on what went wrong internal controls at a company, but how do we prevent internal control breakdowns going forward? And I think one of the biggest opportunities we have as a profession, and we'll talk about this in the panel, isn't just to talk about how we apply internal control auditing today, but how do we make sure as the world shifts, as companies shift, how do we make sure we're helping companies, and therefore for the benefit of investors, getting the right controls in place to deal with tomorrow's problems, staying one step ahead. In simple terminology, it's very easy to point out when there was an accident and why the accident happened. It's a lot harder to say there's going to be an accident, something bad is going to happen, and how do we prevent it? I think that's one of the biggest opportunities we have as a profession, is to work with our stakeholders to make sure we prevent bad things from happening, not just point out when they happened. And we'll talk about that opportunity and on the internal control panel after lunch. Well, as Cindy said, we'll then go into breakout sessions, and our last topic for the day is we'll talk about the importance of research. And I did want to call out that slide because our profession is grounded in research. There's many professions in the United States across the world that there's opinion comes in, conjecture comes in. Our profession is grounded on fact. Our profession is grounded on objectivity, independence, and fundamental research. And what I do worry about sometimes is we don't pay enough attention to research. Especially over the last decade, as the world has changed, the need for more research and what many of you in this room are doing, I would argue the need is higher than we've ever had before. So it's important, and we're going to dedicate 45 minutes to an hour this afternoon talking about research. For those of you in the room who aren't research, you're more practitioners every day or teaching in the classroom, I'd ask that you get to the folks in the room and understand their research. Because that research sets the foundation for change in our profession as the world changes. So please reach out. So that's our day. We're looking for a lot of dialogue. We have plenty of time for Q&A. I would ask respectfully, we've all been invited here. We're all dedicating our time. If you have a question in the middle of something, just raise your hand. It's a small enough group that we ought to be able to keep it informal. And if something's in your mind, let's get it out on the table and get your questions answered, or at least get a dialogue going. So let me jump into the talent topic. So the first topic that we're going to cover is we're going to talk about talent. So last night, or yesterday, was my daughter Riley's 11th birthday. I have 6 children. Their age is 16 to 8. Riley's the second youngest. I'm hanging on to those early years as desperately and slowly as I can. We were at Dave and Buster's. The kids were playing video games. And I was sitting down with my 15-year-old daughter. We were having a Coke while the other kids were playing video games. She's not into video games. Miraculously, there's one who's not into video games. And as we were sitting down, she was a little wound up. I don't know if it was the caffeine or whatever. And she started asking me, "Dad, is the earth going to melt? Are we going to be underwater at the Cape House?" She said, "Dad, what happens if I don't get a job?" And you could see her mind going and going. Then she said, "What happens if the world continues to have all these problems? Am I going to get shot? Is the world safe?" She asked me, "Is her grandparents going to be able to be taken care of as they get aging and they needed health care?" And what caused me to think about that coming in today's session is there are a lot of challenges out there in our society. As Madison and I continued to talk, we then talked about the opportunity. We talked about the opportunity that every single one of her questions presented, because I would tell you, I am incredibly bullish about the future of our world. When I look at the talent that we have at PwC, when I look at the talent that exists at our clients and the other professional services firms, they are up for the biggest challenges that our world presented. And I tend to look at the world as much as glass half full, way more than glass half empty. Are the world's challenges great? Absolutely. I would argue if you go back 100 years ago, there were similar challenges. You go back 200 years ago, there were similar challenges. When you're in the moment, it seems like the things we're doing matter most. The human race has proven over and over again that we can overcome challenges in terms of opportunities. And when I look at the challenges that Madison was talking about, that are being driven by 4 fundamental global megatrends that are driving our world, this profession plays a major role. When you look at what's happening in our world, the first major trend is urbanization. We have 1 billion people moving to cities across the world in the next 25 years. Just think about that. 1 billion people in 25 years across our world move to cities. If you struggle getting here this morning, it starts here in New York. The reality is that affects almost every business. That affects what people in cities expect from transparency. That changed the way we govern, the way companies do business. This profession has a role to help there. The next major megatrend, climate change and resource scarcity. We're short resources across our world. In some places, we're short food. Other places, we're short water. In some places, they don't trust the quality of the food or the safety of the food. No different than internal controls 10 years ago, this profession has an opportunity to help around food trust and food safety. And those questions Madison has about all the worries that are happening in our world, this profession helps. Grounded in research, backed by fact, objectivity, this profession closes the gap between what people like Madison are worrying about, is my food going to be safe? This profession plays a role. The next major trend that's happening out there is we are seeing major changes in our demographics, age, ethnicity, and income inequality. It's in front of our eyes. Unfortunately, we had our latest incident in the United States about a month ago at the beginning of July with the tragic events in Baton Rouge, Minneapolis, Dallas, and again in Louisiana. This profession, as the leading employer of talent across the United States, has an important role to step up and deal with the changing demographics, and not, frankly, not to be afraid of it, but to run to the fire, to help our people become more comfortable dealing with the social issues that we have and make our places the best place to work where people can flourish and then go solve those other challenges. And then the last big megatrend, technological advancements that are happening faster than any of us ever anticipated. We all know it. It's a huge opportunity for us. The reason I like to do that one last is that's the way we deal with urbanization, that's the way we deal with climate and food scarcity, and that's the way we deal with some of the demographic issues. The technological advancements, they are the answer for us. We are living in the day where data is being reproduced at record levels. We are living in the day where trust in data, quality of data, accuracy of data, how data is being used, who owns it, are all questions on the minds of people like my daughter, Madison. And this profession plays a key role in trust in that data. Are the standards there today? No. Why? We have to do the research first, because we don't jump and conclude. We're grounded in research. The people in this room and the people that you'll teach and lead into this profession will help make sure this profession plays a leading role. And that's why I'm bullish. Because when I look at the challenges, they're great. When I look at the foundation of this profession around trust, independence, objectivity, and fact, this profession has a major opportunity to help society with its biggest and most important challenges. And that's where you all come in. What you do every single day, as you're getting ready for another year coming up of teaching students in the classroom, kicking off new research projects, for the profession, welcome new people coming into the profession, we're getting people ready to have careers that most of us could never imagine when we started, and they're getting ready. And in 20 years, they'll be up here talking about how they conquered the things that were on Madison's mind. And that's what you do. And that's hugely impactful. What we're gonna try to do over the next three sessions is make it a little bit easier, hear perspectives. I'd like to tell you we have all the answers today, but we don't. But we will have a really good dialogue. So with that, what I'd like to do is we will begin to kick it off. The way we're gonna start the talent panel is we're first gonna start hearing from two academic perspectives. So I'd like to call our two academics up. We have John Davis, who's from the department head at University of Illinois. We have Chris Hogan, who is a data analytics professor at Michigan State. They're gonna give their perspectives, what they see from an academic perspective on talent, and then we'll go to our panel. So John, I'm gonna turn it over to you first, so thank you.
Thanks, Tim. So they asked us, Chris and I, to come up and give a little bit of background on where things are at in the Academy on Analytics. I wanna start out by setting the stage. So if I go back 4 years ago, I was in New York at one of the big four firms who were hosting a faculty symposium. And it was the first time I heard anything about data analytics and accountancy. And the group that was there was talking about analytics, how important it was going to be, but nobody could really put their finger on exactly what analytics was or what people were looking for. And I think the group was driving for some definition around what we should be doing, but nobody could really say. Roll forward 2 years. There was a lot of buzz in the year after that. A lot of faculty were talking. Some people were saying this is a passing fad. You know, the firm's going to move on in 2 years. By the time we start down this path, they'll be on to something else. Well, that hasn't happened. 2 years ago, a lot of things started to happen in the academy. And also, the firm started to really step up and give us some more definition. KPMG in the UK put out a white paper 2 years ago around analytics in education. PwC in the US did the same. And both those white papers gave a fair amount of definition around what the firms were looking for in terms of knowledge, skills, and abilities that they needed from students in accounting. At the same time, in 2013, the AACSB issued new standards for accounting programs for accreditation. And one of the new standards was standard A7, which requires accounting programs to do something around data and analytics in the curriculum. And they gave a 3 to 4 year phase-in window. That's going to be 2017, where AACSB is going to start looking for response from schools. Well, at this point, AAA has stepped in. They've had one symposium in New York. They're about to have another one on accounting is big data. So they're starting to provide resources for schools, and I'm happy to report a lot of schools are stepping up and really starting to make some changes to address the needs of the profession. Now, for the professionals in the room, you guys have to recognize that this is breakneck speed for the academy. Chris mentioned a little bit earlier this morning that it takes 2 years to get a title change on a course through campus, and she's right. It takes 18 months to 2 years to get something like that done. And we're talking about rolling out whole new classes or making major changes to curriculum. So that's a lot of hoops you have to jump, particularly in public schools. So what I'm here to do is, now that I've set the groundwork for this, I want to talk a little bit about what Illinois is doing in response. And that's just one example. There's a lot of people here. I know at their schools they're also doing things. So this is just to provide an example and cue things up. At Illinois, about 2 years ago, we had an external curriculum review where we had a lot of our advisory board members and a lot of other people do a deep dive in our curriculum and weigh in and talk about how we should be doing things, what might change. By far and away, the biggest vote getter, almost a mandate from that group, was we need to position ourselves to be the data analytics accounting program. They really thought we need to brand ourselves that way. Now, a lot of other schools are doing the same thing, but I'm going to tell you kind of what we're doing. So our approach, we've got a four-step strategy to do this. The first step is the easy lift for us. We're rolling out a specialization in our master's degree. Why the master's? Well, first off, a significant number of our students really don't have access to a specialization, so there's a tendency for a race to the bottom. Students take random courses to fill in the credit hours they need for the master's beyond our required classes. Those are offered by other departments in the college or elsewhere on campus. We have very little control over those, and I think it reduces the increment to human capital we could be providing through the master's that we're not providing. So this gives us a chance to really raise the value of the master's degree and give the students a significant skill set that's going to pay off for them over the course of their career. And we also control the curriculum in the master's, so it's easy for us to do. So that's the first thing we're going to do. Step two is already underway. The College of Business is doing a curriculum review in the undergraduate core, and we will probably be introducing a two-course analytics sequence in the business core, because it's not just accounting now that needs analytics. People in finance need to know analytics. People in human resources need to know analytics. People in marketing need to know analytics. So this is really becoming core knowledge in business. So that's the second step. The third step for us, which we haven't gotten to yet, is thinking about creative ways to implement changes in our major so we lever the knowledge they get in the business core. So we reinforce that as they go through the major in accountancy. And then once those students hit the specialization in their fifth year, we'll raise the bar and really make the specialization that we're rolling out a much more intense experience. So. And how do we get started on this? Well, I started out with an interdisciplinary faculty committee. There's faculty governance at Illinois, like pretty much every other school. I had on that committee some accountancy faculty, faculty from information science, faculty from information systems, faculty from statistics, and an astronomy professor. Now, it turns out astronomy actually has a lot to say about this. They're very much into big data, and the professor I used in that on the committee is also with National Center for Supercomputing Applications, and he's really a big data guy. He's not really an astronomer. So they got together, and they thought about what we should do to bring analytics into the master's. They came back and proposed a three-course sequence. And they provided me with some sample syllabi. The problem was I ended up with three sample syllabi for each of the classes except for the accounting class, because information systems, information science, and astronomy all had different views about what the analytics should look like. So we sat down, came up with kind of a compromise, sent the syllabi out to three of the big four firms for feedback. And we got some really directed feedback from the firms, and for the most part, it was consistent. There was a little bit of difference depending on who was talking, and I think there were some idiosyncrasies weighing in based on individual partner experiences, but I think we came up with a pretty good compromise. At the end of the day, the three classes in our specialization are statistical analytics and machine learning. Included in that is data visualization and a lot of other things that I've been hearing about the last couple days at a symposium we were at from one of the firms. Computational analytics, and in this class is things like SQL, handling unstructured data, blending data, managing data, cleaning data, things like that. And then the last class in the sequence is accounting applications, focusing on things in accounting and the tools that are being used in accounting, and also a hands-on practicum for the students. So we'll be rolling this out in basically this year. We're doing a pilot, only 40 students. We'll be rolling out rolling it out much on a much bigger scale in a year. The way this fits in, we have basically two five-course tracks in our master's degree. We've got a five-course audit sequence and a five-course tax sequence. The specialization fits on top. Right now, about 25% of our students get into specific specializations in corporate governance, finance, international business, business and public policy, but 80% of our students don't. This analytics specialization will be the default sequence for the students who don't get into those other specializations. So we'll be looking at about 80% of our students doing this. That's about 200 students a year that'll be doing the analytics specialization. Lastly, staffing. This is a big lift because these are accounting classes and I need to find people that can deliver these classes. This first year, I'm using the astronomy professor to do it. I've actually hired him over into accountancy. And also an accounting professor on the managerial side who's very interested in analytics. It's kind of a natural fit. Several of our managerial people have some interest. Next year, we'll scale it to six sections, and we'll hopefully fill that up by either hiring another person from NCSA, or we'll be using Slack elsewhere on campus. Our Information Sciences College has a bit of Slack. The good news is, this is actually pretty cheap from a financial perspective for the department. The full professor in astronomy we're hiring, I think his salary is about $110,000, $120,000, which is less than half of what we pay an assistant professor in accounting. So this is actually a pretty cheap lift, if not a little bit out of the box. So that's all I have to say. Chris?
Good morning. Before I jump into my remarks, I just want to say on behalf of the auditing section that I would like to thank the CAQ and PwC, the sponsor for this year, and all of the professionals in the audience for hosting and participating in this seminar today. This has become a really important part of the annual meeting, and it's such a valuable learning experience, I think, for all of us. So I just want to say thank you. All right, what I'm going to talk about are some of the changes that we can make just at our individual course level. We, at Michigan State, we've made some of the big changes, like what John talked about. We have a master's in business analytics program. That is actually outside of our accounting, so that is different from what they're going to be implementing. We're talking about the course or courses that we're going to implement at the undergraduate level. But I think, I agree with what John said, that we really need to incorporate this into all of our classes. I teach, I don't teach in the analytics program, I teach auditing, but there are many things that I can do to help our students just get that mindset so that they are ready to at least, work with the data and be able to evaluate the data, even if they're not the ones that are, doing the computational aspects of it. So that's what I want to focus my remarks on. And I'm just going to share with you some of the resources that I have found to be very helpful in doing that. I think that most of us already, have over several years have moved towards a much more interactive, case-based classroom experience. And so I think once you have that, it's very easy then to slot in, cases related to professional judgment, to analytics, to data visualization. And so my approach has been to kind of start, for me personally, to start slowly and add stuff as I go into my class. In terms of trying to incorporate an analytics mindset, and I really view that as my role in teaching auditing or other classes, is to just help the students with the mindset, right? And so we have a lot of our colleagues. I was actually very impressed over the last year in my role and the things I've gotten to do and the people that I've got to interact with. Our colleagues who teach have been very innovative, I think, in terms of what they're doing in the classroom related to both analytics and professional judgment. And the software providers, I think, have been fabulous as well from an educational perspective. So the companies such as Tableau, SAS, ACL, IDEA, Teammate Analytics, all of these companies are very willing to work with us and have, educational subscriptions. Our students can get these things for free. And so they, I think, have made it much more easy for us to incorporate these tools into our classrooms. I use Tableau in my auditing class, and for me, it took some, I had to tool up for that. I went to a two-day training class that Tableau offered, which was great, But what you'll find is that the students don't need any time at all. You know, in the first 5 minutes of the day that we worked with the Tableau software, the students had it all figured out, and they were just doing amazing things. And I just kind of give them open-ended questions, and they run with it. And so the students love these tools, and so they're going to make it easy for you as well, I think, to incorporate these in your classroom. Let me mention a few other resources that I've used. First, I'm going to put in a plug for our auditing section, Excellence in Audit Education workshops that we do before the mid-year meeting. The last 2 years, these have been very related to talent initiatives. So we had one on professional judgment, and then this last year on analytics. So the topic of the last workshop, which was led by Jason Smith, was on incorporating an analytics mindset into our auditing classes. And the workshop is just such an excellent collaboration, I think, between a lot of the firms in this represented in this room today and the academics in terms of developing case materials, helping us to teach these tools to the students, helping us understand what it is you want the students to know. So those workshops are an excellent collaboration, and I would encourage you to register for this year's workshop when the registration comes out, because they're already starting to work on the topic for this year. In terms of last year's workshop, Jason and I shared the materials that were developed with the workshop participants through Dropbox. And so if you were not able to attend that workshop but would like to see those resources, connect with either Jason Smith or you can ask me as well, and we can get those materials to you. The firms brought in examples of how they use data visualization on the audit engagements, and some of our colleagues had excellent examples of cases that they are currently using in class. I have also seen an increasing number of cases related to analytics in issues in accounting education, for example, or in our own current issues in auditing journal. Also, many of the audit firms, again, here today, have cases in their academic resources website, and I've seen an increase in the number of cases that are related to analytics. So I would encourage you to check that regularly. You know, if you checked 2 years ago and you didn't find anything that you thought was useful, check again, because they're being added regularly. The AAA, again, is hosting their second Accounting is Big Data conference, which also has, you know, resources available and, again, helps us understand what's going on in practice. If you can't attend that conference, I know it always conflicts with the start of my semester, so I cannot attend it, but they do regular webinars and they post those materials as well. I think in this endeavor, we really need to help each other as academics to implement this. And so if you are working on cases that you're using in your class, I would really encourage you to submit those to the issues in accounting education, also to current issues in auditing. And for any of the practitioners in the audience, if you are not familiar with the Current Issues in Auditing journal, it is designed, it's an online journal through the auditing section that's designed to be a collaboration between practice and academics. And so you could imagine the thrill when you get your first academic publication. I see the excitement there. I would encourage you to collaborate with academics on some of these topics and help us develop cases, and, you know, we can submit those to the journal so that we can share them with everyone. Those are great resources for us. Okay. So finally, I also, you know, think it's important to begin pushing these topics down into the undergraduate curriculum. I think many of us, you know, Illinois is starting at the master's level. We did the same thing. We often, when we introduce new initiatives, we do it at the master's level. But I think we really need to begin doing this at the undergraduate level as well, because so many of our students now, we're going to be talking about this topic later today, I think, so many of our students are leaving at the undergraduate phase, right? They either came in with a lot of hours, or they get their 150 hours as an undergraduate, or they pick up the extra hours at a local school. And we need to make sure that these students have these tools as well, right? Not just our master's students. So I think that at Michigan State, one of the things that we're focusing on is beginning to think about, okay, we're doing this at the master's level now. How do we incorporate this at the undergraduate level? So thank you. I look forward to the rest of this panel and to our sessions later today.
So Chris and John, thank you very much. And when we get to Q&A after the panel, Chris and John will be available for questions as well. What I'd like to do now is introduce my panelists to come up. So we'll start with Lynne Doughtie from KPMG is here. Cathy Engelbert from Deloitte. Carolyn Slaski from EY, who is the EY talent leader for the Americas. And Jeff Burgess from Grant Thornton, who runs their audit business. So while they're coming up, I just want to do a show of hands. How many of us know how to use Tableau or a similar tool that Chris talked about? Okay, so the first step is we all got to get up to speed on that, okay? Because as Chris said, all of our young people are using that, and they expect us to be able to use it too. Okay, so with that, welcome folks, thank you very much. So we're gonna dive right into it. We have a couple of questions, and then we'll leave time for Q&A. So the first one is, we've all adjusted our talent strategies to go after STEM and data analytics hires, given what Chris and John had talked about. So maybe first, Lynne, we'll start with you. How have you at KPMG adjusted recruiting and trying to acquire that type of talent? What do you look for?
Well, we absolutely do need to adjust, because you talked about the mega trends, and we heard how organizations are fundamentally changing business models. And this came out in a recent CEO survey that we did, about 1,300 CEOs, that said that they believe that there will be more change in their organization in the next 3 years than has occurred in the past 50 years combined. And I mean, you think about the past 50 years and the change that's happened, and that in the next three, there will be even more. And so as we think about our profession and how are we prepared to protect the capital markets as there is a significant amount of change, we need to think about how is our talent changing. And one of the points that John made is a challenge that we have. You know, jobs and companies are changing faster than historically we've ever been able to change degrees in an academic setting. And so that creates a big challenge, but opportunity for us. And so I think the creative things that we heard about earlier at Illinois, I mean, one of the things that I think will require us to do is more collaboration. You know, we can't do this, you know, by individual firms. Organizations can't handle it, you know, just by themselves. So we're seeing, I think one of the opportunities is more partnering, more joint ventures. I think all of our firms are doing quite a bit of that. And I think that means more partnering with the academics. And so one of the things that, you know, just to give you an example of one of the strategies that we have been pursuing is a master's in data and analytics tied to accounting. I think it solves a couple of things. You know, one is, and we've been criticized by a lot of you in the past about not valuing the master's program. And I think when you talk about this, the mega trends earlier, we need students who are getting advanced degrees because they need it to do what we do. And so I think us being able to partner, to show that we value the advanced degrees, looking at analytics and data, having the data, you know, driven auditor, I mean, that's gonna be key for all of us. And I think we've gotta be in this together to create the talent pool that's gonna allow us to protect the capital markets in this ever-changing environment.
Great, Tim, maybe just one add-on to that. I was at a university recently and got asked a question by a student, you know, did I disadvantage myself by selecting accounting over a technology or STEM major? And I said, absolutely not. I would have never thought sitting here today, 30 years later, that I would have the knowledge of how systems and processes have evolved at the clients we audit. I never would have thought I would have had a deep understanding of whether it's SAP or Oracle, or whether now it's cloud and blockchain. And so I tried to convince them, and I think we all need to storytell around this, convince them that, you know, you are a data-driven auditor and you will be able to be a technologist. I was recently at the Detroit Economic Club where the theme was, every company is a technology company. And I said, I got up there and said, that's a great theme, but every company needs to be a data company. And we're all drowning in data, starving for insights. So I tell the same thing to students. If we can solve, and our profession, as Tim said earlier, so well positioned to solve a lot of these issues using data and helping companies, you know, get the insights out of the data that they're drowning in. And we all know because we sit there with these companies as they struggle through it. So I think it's really important, though, to have our story for this profession, that we're well positioned, and that it doesn't mean you need to go do STEM or, you know, because you are a technologist just by virtue of auditing the companies that are all becoming technology and data companies.
Yeah, and I think just to add to that, the other thing I would add is we need to do a better job of telling our story, because you often get the question, are you going to need as much of us? So as we're up here, and this is the key reason for this panel, is we need more of these types of folks. But they sit there and say, doesn't technology equal less jobs? And the reality is it doesn't. It's doing jobs differently, and there's also significant growth given the megatrends that we talked about. So one of the things that you'll see us continue to work on is the messaging through the CAQ of the increased demand that we see, and the data actually does create more and more demands. So Cathy, maybe segue. We're seeing a growing gap between the number of people growing from accounting programs, coming from accounting programs, but not necessarily sitting for the CPA exam. Just perspective on that, and do we worry about that, and how do we figure out how to close that gap?
Yeah, it's definitely something we should worry about, and I know Barry worries about it. I don't know if Barry's in the room from the AICPA, and I think the main thing is we need to make sure, again, storytelling will play a big part of this, that we're storytelling around the value of being licensed as a CPA, and why that's important to us as a profession and why it's important to our clients. Again, I started out in college as a computer science engineering major, and when I had to take my first programming course, so back to your Tableau question, I jumped out, and I jumped out because of things that still are true today. One, it's a language of business, accounting. Two, you can get a job. That was helpful too at the time. But three, the experience and exposure you get in your 20s in this profession is unequaled to other jobs. And I know my husband's an engineer, and I've seen his trajectory at his company that he's been with for 30 years versus mine. And it is enormously a message we need to send about the certifications, the licensing, the value. I mean, we build a product called trust. And you know, that is an important thing. And I think you talked about the millennials and this purpose over profits and planet and purpose over profits. And I think if we tell our story better, and that's one of the things that we're doing as part of the talent initiative at the CAQ, is really trying to get out there and tell a story, a day in a life. Nobody would understand really what an auditor does without the day in the life. Targeting people earlier in their careers. Someone suggested middle school. I'm not sure we have to go by that far, but certainly at the high school level. I know in New Jersey, where I reside, we have a pay it forward program to get high school students interested in what we do, but we can't do it without the day in the life type stories. So I think it's really important that we value the licensing. I'm mildly worried about it, Tim, around the CPA. People not sitting for the exam, but maybe it's because we're not valuing. I know in our firms we value it highly. We pay bonuses, right, and extra, and do some extra things around it. But it's outside the profession, outside the firms, that we need to get the momentum.
Okay.
It's funny. I started as an engineer as well, so just to, and then became an accountant. But with regards to CPI, I couldn't agree more. I think the valuing of that. We're not seeing a decrease in the number of one of our people that are getting the CPA because they have to. But what we want to do is get them getting it sooner. And we actually had a pilot in one of our offices that now we're putting across all of them. And I mentioned this because I think it could be helpful for the academics to help support this, is we when students are coming, before they even started with us, we team them up with someone in our firm who had just passed the exam. And through that little mentoring relationship, someone who they could just talk to, there's the peer pressure of just kind of keeping them on track, asking questions and whatnot. We saw the number of our people passing right even before they started, or right after they started, almost double. Because it just that connection with someone. So it's just something to think about if you're talking to your students, just encouraging them to just grab somebody that has had that, because that mentoring can make a big deal.
Tim, I think too, on the softer side, and you kind of hit on this earlier in your remarks, is that to make sure that the students understand how dynamic our profession is and the difference that we make not just to the companies that we work with or the investing public, but to, you know, to society overall. I think that's really important to the millennials, and I don't think that the perception's out there with that group that we're as dynamic and innovative and a society-changing profession like you pointed out before, and I think that's key.
Yeah, I think that's important to point out. It's a great point in tying together the comments. Once people are joining the firms, that our turnover rates are actually very good, right, in terms of the profession where we are right now. The challenge is getting more in and then helping them practically with how to get that exam through, and that's probably a good opportunity for us to collectively collaborate more. Mm-hmm. So let me shift gears. I mentioned what was happening demographically. We all talk about diversity almost on a regular basis right now. But Carolyn, I'm going to come to you. The reality is there's still a big gap in terms of what's coming to the profession. A, your perspective, and B, what are some of the things we should be thinking about together?
Yeah, there definitely is a gap there. And, you know, we're all doing a lot of the same things to try to build the pool, right? And then all trying to get our fair share of that pool. So there's a lot of competition for the small pool of diverse students that are coming in out of the program. So that's one. So, you know, we do a lot of things to help get them to maybe fund a master's program and things like that. I think we all are doing things to encourage that. But I would agree, I know you mentioned going down into the middle schools, but I really do think the amount that we can invest in getting to the high schools to really talk to the students about a profession in accounting is, you cannot underestimate that. I was at, we had a group of students from inner city school in a group that we have coming in as like interns and mentors, and not necessarily accounting. So I asked them, it was very interesting. I asked them, I said, so what do you want to, you know, what do you want to do when you like go to college? Like, what do you want to study? And the top ones were they want to be lawyers, they want to go into criminal justice or into healthcare, which are all very, you know, good career. Well, let's see, except for the lawyers, but I mean, very.
Cindy, where's Cindy?
Sorry. but they're notable careers. But what was fascinating, so I just started talking about being an accountant. And of course, they're all kind of looking at me like, you know. And so what I talked about is, you know, my career a little bit, and I just talked about, you know, the opportunities that I've had. I'm a first generation college student, so like probably like a lot of them. And talked about that, you know, I got to live overseas, I got to do these, I got to do all this, I have children, I've had a family. So the opportunity to do all that. But then I asked them, I said, what would be your guess? And I said, the doors close, it's gonna be, you know, it's just amongst us. The doors close, how much do you think a brand new partner makes at a firm? And of course, they were way low. And I shared with them, and I shared with them what a trajectory could look like. Their faces just drained, and what they said is, you know, and I said, so how many of you want to be accountants now? And then all of their hands go up. But I think we do ourselves a disservice, and it's not all about money, but for students like that, you know, we really need to do more to attract them to the profession.
I totally agree with Carolyn. I think we've got to go, we do have to go back. I mean, by the time they get to college, it's too late. Yeah. And so to get that demographic that all of us are looking for so desperately, I mean, and we need it because of the demographic change that you mentioned, and that, I mean, I truly believe that we will be better professionals if we have more diverse teams. And so I think going back and doing the awareness, some of the things that we did this year with CAQ on the social blast, I mean, that's an example. It's telling the story. But I think this is one of those topics where, you know, working together, I mean, you are desiring them in your schools. You know, we want them in our firms. And right now, the pool is just way too low. Yes. And I think we've got to really come up with some creative ways to get that awareness that this is an amazing profession to be a part of and, you know, join us. And I think if we could tell our story a little bit better, we would get the numbers up.
Yeah, and another thing we're doing as part of the CAQ Talent Initiative is looking at this issue of how do we attract the pool. We're going to the Baltimore, Miami, and we're kind of going to pilot a program where we can bring people from inner city schools and get some interest in the profession. I was struck, I was out at the USC, the Leventhal School at USC, the accounting school there, for their graduation this year, and I was struck by the enormous diversity of the graduates in that school. And so the question I had for my team was, how many of them are coming into our profession broadly, not just Deloitte? How many are coming into the profession? Because I would say 60 to 70% of that class was what we would call diverse in our numbers. And we really need to make sure that we're attracting them into the profession, we're attracting them to be licensed, become CPAs, and no matter whether they stay within in the firms or not, but ultimately go out and practice in this great profession. So there's no doubt, as Lynne said, it's a huge challenge.
Right.
We've got to be creative. I think we have a good start with what we're going to do with the CAQ and pilot it, because I know all the firms, we have our different programs as well. But this is really important, because when we get to 2040, the workforce is going to be diverse. If we don't have it in our profession, we're going to be left behind.
I agree. So maybe just to want to build off these comments and get to a practical, so go ahead, we'll go. There's a question. I said we'll take them right away. We are. Just get a mic, just because it's being videotaped, and I want everybody to hear it. Thanks, Margo.
Thanks, Tim. I'm taking you at your word that
yes.
You said you wanted questions. So
yes, thank you.
I don't know if you have this later on your agenda, mm-hmm. but it struck me, Cathy, when you were talking about what you saw in the way of diversity, part of that is because of the international students. And I don't know if you're thinking diversity in terms of international students, but that's really an opposite problem. We have the pool, but they can't get through your door. And could you talk a little bit about what we can do and work together? Because we have international students that just aren't able to get jobs
right.
with you. Thanks.
Yeah, I'll just comment quickly. Diversity, very broadly defined. As international students, as well as here at home and underrepresented minorities, and even women to some extent, that's typically more of a retention, not an attraction issue right now. But so I do think, Savannah, that there are things we can be doing around international students, not to get into politics here, but obviously some decent immigration reform would be helpful. To this very challenging issue we have of having these international students who are schooled here ultimately then come to work for us and have a career with us, long-term career. So that is an issue,
right.
But policy, not politics. If we could get good immigration reform, we'd be in a better place.
Yeah, and just to build off of that, and thanks for the first question, the reality is when you look at the different elements of demographics that this profession is trying to track, which is all of them, that when you break it down, there's very different challenges. As Cathy said, in some cases, this is simply a flat-out pipeline problem. We just don't have enough people coming in. And blacks clearly in that group. Latinos would be clearly in that group. When you look at what's, in many cases, what's being educated in your campuses, to generalize, we have a very large group of people from overseas, Asian population, that desperately want to come to work at our firms. And we see that when we're at a campus, whether I'm at Wake Forest, Illinois, Lehigh, like we see it over and over again where they want to come. And the reality is, as Cathy pointed out today, we are constrained. That being said, here's a couple of things we're doing, again, within the constraints of the current rules today. What we are trying to do is match them up with our network firms. So A, manage expectations. Like the reality is there are only so many folks given current immigration rules we can bring in place. But if you have people who want to work back in their home country, we do have, we're structured in a way that we have network firms, whether it be in China, Indonesia, India. If those individuals want to go back home, we're equally vested in having to find the way within our network firms to grow their careers that way. Because the reality is we can't accommodate all of them today. So that would be one thing. If you do have people who want to work in the profession, A, let's manage expectations, and B, connect them with our overseas firms as well, which we're reasonably well connected.
And I do wonder, and Carolyn, it would be good to hear your perspective on this. With this whole open talent network, this ultimately having employees off the balance sheet, not on the balance sheet, to use an accountant term,
yes.
Will really change the game for this and how we actually then source talent through the open talent networks. There's a prediction that 20%, not in the profession, but 20% of our workforce in the U.S. by 2020 will be sourced through open talent networks. And so I have some concerns about underrepresented minorities and diversity in that, because all of our leadership development and the way we develop our people is all on the balance sheet. So I do have some concerns on that, but I do wonder if that's going to be advantageous, where people don't live where they work or work where they live anymore anyway, even in the U.S., let alone can we get the best talent pool around the world, given globalization and given open talent network sourcing, doesn't matter that, you know, whether you have a visa or not.
The whole idea of these open networks and gigs, you know, they call them, that people want to just kind of, you know, plop in and be contracted workers. It's an area, though, I think we're all looking at, and just how do we manage through that? Because, you know, as you said, the training that you do, but, you know, there's the culture piece of it as well, right? And the you know, the quality piece. I mean, there's a lot of aspects of this that I think we're all working through now. We don't have all the answers. We know that we need to work through it, because that's what a lot of our younger people want. They want to be able to plug in certain places, but it may help the diversity side. But there's just a lot of things we have to work through with the whole, open network.
So maybe we'll switch gears, and again, we'll take questions as we go. And Jeff, maybe I'll go to you. So
hold on.
Oh, I'm sorry.
There's a question.
Sorry. Thank you.
We'd much rather take questions.
Yeah.
I thought you were going to move on.
No, I'm sorry.
So I had a question about the underrepresented. As you can tell, I am very, very interested in how we go about this, because it is a question and an issue that has been going on forever. Mm-hmm. So one of the issues, I believe, is that in a lot of the African American Hispanic communities, there are not enough role models. There are not enough people that have actually gone into the profession. And we may have all of these tools, a day in the life, and, you know, these additional programs at the college, but if I don't see me as an African American woman, I'm not a woman, I'm an African American woman, it's very hard to make the connection to the profession being one that is one that I can survive in. So I know it puts an additional burden on those that are in the profession that are in these underrepresented categories, but what are you doing and how are you thinking about approaching it to make it real so that 10 years from now, I'm not sitting back in this room hearing us talk about underrepresentation in two areas, particularly the Hispanic area, that is going to become a major part of our demographic?
It's a big issue, Michelle, and I think that, you know, well, some of the things that we've done, and I'm sure, you know, my colleagues up here will say the same thing, is, you know, we have to do something special when we get underrepresented African American, Hispanic groups in KPMG, so that when, you know, you want to see someone who is like you creating sort of the networks, the mentoring, the, you know, groups of people who are saying, this is how we're gonna, ensure that there is a very inclusive and welcoming environment. We also were trying to do that with the PhD program as well, that we started a long time ago, so that even you're seeing someone like you on campus teaching the classes who are African American in the professors teaching, which is critically important as well. And so I think that this requires us to do something very different, and I think that we've got to, as I said earlier, it's got to start with enticing them to go into the programs to begin with, and then once they're there, to feel like they are part of a community and they're not the only one. And so it does create we have a small percentage of African American partners in our firm that I'm not proud of. I wish it were much more. But that group, I can tell you, is passionate about how are they going to make a difference. And I think all of us are going to have to, I worry about the international students, but I worry about this one every single day, because the pool is not there, and we've got to find a way collectively to increase that pool. And then once they're with us, that we solve that leaky bucket problem too, that it's an inclusive environment to stay with us.
Yeah. One of the things that we've done is we've established business resource groups and for different groups within our firm, and certainly one of those is for underrepresented communities. And as Lynne said, you know, our partners that are in those categories certainly our leaders in those groups, but it's not just folks that are in those categories. It's also other people, all of us collaborating together to help drive the success more and more of our underrepresented, because I agree, in order to recruit underrepresented folks off campus, we have to have proven successful folks in those groups in our firms to be able to be successful.
And I'll just add, this is really hard. We're really bad at it, I think, as a profession. I think we're probably a D, and maybe we're an F 10 years ago, but we're going to be a C or a D, Michelle, in 10 years if we don't do something, I think, a little more aggressive. Maybe it's community college recruiting. Maybe it's some other way. Maybe it's what we're at least going to pilot at the CAQ and scaling that, but you got to scale it across the country. I don't think we can continue to blame it on that fifth year and the cost, although that's part of it, and I know many of the professors in this room are challenged with keeping minority students in programs that require that extra year and the cost. I really do think, I don't have the answer. I wish we could push a button and had the answer. I think role models is a huge part of it, as it was for me with women growing up in the firm over 30 years, but I don't think role models is the only thing. We need to be very aggressive and do something to put ourselves a little more, you know, get us to a C or a B. Okay.
So, Michelle, I'll just add, because I think it's important to hear from all of us on this one. So, without a doubt, this is a big issue. The reality is, the way we've looked at it, there's no one silver bullet. That being said, we as leaders of the profession have to be willing to take some risk here. And I'll just share with you something that we just did at PwC that was very risky. So after the Dallas shootings, we sat down. So I had been in the senior partner chair for 5 days. And after the the shootings, we sat down with my new team and we said, what are we gonna do? And we know it's on the minds, it's gonna be in the minds of some of our people, not knowing who's thinking what at this point in time. And we talked about reaching out, and we talked about being responsive. And as you can imagine, given the political side of this, given the nervousness, the legal side of this, there was the media side of this, there was every viewpoint represented at my table. And finally made the decision that we're gonna reach out, and we're gonna acknowledge the issue, that it's probably on a lot of our people's minds. We sent a communication to our staff. We got over 1,000 emails from our people we sent out on a Friday. We got over 1,000 emails. The common theme going through those emails was, we will talk about anything at work. We'll talk about GLBT, we'll talk about a healthcare issue, we'll talk about a client issue, a parent issue, a spousal issue, but we are uncomfortable talking about Black, just to be very clear. It came across loud and clear. We then spent the weekend going through those, and I read every single one of them that came my way, and it was clear we needed to give permission to say it's okay to talk about it, which then introduced a whole nother element of risk if we're having a real conversation about it. We then, that Thursday, so literally 6 days later, had a firm-wide discussion on race in the workplace. You can imagine the hand-wringing that went on my team of allowing that discussion to happen. It happened in big groups, small groups, out of teams, out of client sites, the whole risk with that happening. I happened to do the Atlanta session in front of the folks in Atlanta in a session like this. I opened up by saying, this is either gonna go really good or really bad. Now, fortunately, it went very well. Not everywhere, to be clear, across the country, but what we did is we learned what it felt like from every perspective that then gives us the foundation to really understand what it's like to be in other people's shoes. That then gives us the ability to improve our retention rates. That gives us the ability to then create even more role models, because to Lynn's point, we're putting way too much pressure on the small number that we have already from role model perspective. Now, we can't stop there, but I would tell you that not the silver bullet, but the basic nuts and bolts of this is we have to be willing to talk about not up here that it's important to do, but down here what's really encumbering people from growing in the firms today, which will then build the foundation for going further.
Yeah, you know, I would say it was an example. We did something similar, and it was those small group settings where the conversation happened that did open up the just the permission to have the conversation. And it was uncomfortable conversations, and uncomfortable for both, for everyone there, regardless of your race. But I think it was finally a time where people, and the response has been, we feel like we're at a place where we can actually have those conversations and how important those are. So, you know, making a little lemonade out of some lemons because it was, you know, being given that permission is just huge.
Okay, we'll take
some questions.
Yeah, so, Jeff Brown, I'm dean at Illinois College of Business. This is a great discussion. I'm sure it won't surprise you that at the level of the colleges, we face a very similar problem, which is we're trying to recruit underrepresented students, and we find that there's at least four things we need to do to be successful there. One, and underscoring the importance of getting into the high schools, is kids today, I mean, they know what a teacher does, they might know what a doctor or a lawyer does. Most of them don't know what accountants or really any business person does. We are trying to partner with some of the Chicago-based organizations that work in Chicago public schools, where only 14% of the kids go on to get a college degree. And we've actually reached out to some of your firms, and they've been great partners in starting to have conversations about how we can get high school kids some exposure to the profession while they're in high school and bring them forward. But then obviously they need financial aid, they need support systems while in place, and then to Michelle's point, they also need to see people like them on the faculty. And the PhD project has been wonderful in that regard, but we still have about 1,300 minority faculty business professors in the US, and there are 1,600 business schools. So there's fewer on average than one per accredited business school in the US. And so we also have some work to do to increase representativeness of in the diversity of business school faculty. So I agree it's going to be a long effort, but we very much hear the need to increase the diversity of our students that are on their way out. We've got to increase the diversity of the students that we're attracting on the way in, and I think we're all going to have to partner together to make that happen.
Yeah, agree.
Great point.
Well said. Is there other questions? Thanks, Jeff. All right, so Jeff, we'll go to you. So, switching gears a bit, but so on the topic of millennials, which a couple of us have mentioned from time to time, they have different expectations around voices being heard, transparency, everything must be out in the open. How do you think about that at Grant? What should we be thinking about dealing with millennials in a day and age where many cases things aren't meant to be out in the open?
Well, it ain't easy. You know, it's interesting. We talk a lot about generations in our firm, and millennials in particular. And, you know, if you think about it, a big part of us are baby boomers. You know, in baby boomers, if your boss said something to you, you were generally concerned that you'd probably done something wrong. With the millennials, if the boss doesn't talk to you, they're afraid they've done something wrong. You know, for us, if you had three or four jobs on your resume by the time you were 30, that probably meant you were unemployable. Right. Today, our millennials, if they don't have three or four jobs on their resume by the time they're 30, they don't think that they're progressing the way they should. So a lot of issues in dealing with millennials. You know, in our firm, I think it all goes to culture. We spend a lot of time in our firm working on collaboration. And we've done a good bit of education with all of our people on the generations and the differences in the way that millennials think versus the way that the baby boomers and the Gen Xers think. We've implemented what we call a culture journey, and all of our people go through a two-day unfreezing where we talk about things like personality styles and the way we communicate. And a lot of that is driven around trying to help us be able to communicate with millennials and give millennials an ability to be transparent and communicate with us. We have monthly culture conversations. We're doing a lot in our performance management system to try to move away from the focus being on documenting formal reviews and spending more time trying to have coaching sessions, one-on-one coaching sessions. We really encourage our millennials to be the captains of their own career and that they have an open door to help us understand what they need. We talk a lot about building a resume, whether that resume is for a future job outside of our firm, or whether it's a resume for promotion within our firm, or whether it's a resume for a potential client that's going to help us win that client. So there's a lot of things that we're doing, but again, I think most of it goes back to culture and truly understanding the differences of what makes the millennials tick, because I believe that the millennials are just as driven as the baby boomers were. They're just driven differently, and we have to meet them on their turf.
And maybe just to tag on a little bit to that, two quick stories. One is I have an 18-year-old daughter who is constantly on Instagram, Snapchat, and she posts an Instagram. Within 5 minutes, she has 500 likes. I mean, I don't even know 500 people who would like anything I would post. 500 likes in 5 minutes. And so this performance management aspect of the millennials, and obviously the professors in the room absolutely know what we're talking about. It's just not going to work to evaluate them once or twice a year or to do these formal things. They're going to want constant feedback, touch points. So we've taken out ratings at Deloitte. We took them out this summer. And we had piloted it last summer and just said, we're not going to do that anymore. And we're having more frequent touch points. Huge plus, I think, from, and it's really, we're now looking at the digital native. If you read the New York Times article about, you know, you had, you know, baby boomers, Gen X, Gen Y, millennials, now Gen Z, which are the digital natives, which are your kids and my kids. So another quick story. So talking to my son, 15 years old, what does he want to do in life? And he's an Xboxer, so you want to trade? I'll trade for your daughter. And doing all that. And now he's into augmented reality with Pokemon Go. Mm. And there's good and bad to that. The good is, you know, he's actually getting out and running a mile to go find these things, you know? And so he's not sitting as a couch potato in front of Xbox, but he's gonna be looking for even something different than my daughter, who's already in a business school, is looking for. So, and I actually have, you know, we were joking, Carol and I, beforehand that, you know, you get these jobs and you ought to be automatically become an expert on millennials. I actually don't think they're that different than we are. I think they may be in their 20s. Thank you, Mark Zuckerberg, for that. As Jeff mentioned, they all want to be CEOs in 5 years. But I don't know about you, but I was 2 years and out. Get certified, get my CPA license, and out, took the corporate world. And 30 years later, I'm still here. So I don't think they're that different. I think there's this thing in the 20s where they do want to be the CEO in 3 to 5 years versus we never had that aspiration. And so we need to be careful about what we do, I think, in the 20s. But I think once we get them in their 30s and they have something to conserve, they become more like us.
Right. Yeah, I'm of the mindset that they're not that different. Thinking back to myself and seeing my children as well and our younger folks at the firm. But I think that they want to move faster than we did. I mean, we were willing to. Somebody told me it was going to take me 13 years to be a partner. I'm like, okay, that sounds pretty good, you know, 13. They want to be there sooner, and they're just much more vocal about what they do want. And so we just kind of tag it as they want personalization. They just want to be more, they want a personalization of their career track, of their discussions, of the feedback. It has to be personalized. And I don't think that's difficult, and it's not that much to ask for, quite honestly. You just have to kind of get the processes in place to get them there.
I think they also want variety, and that's what we offer. And that's why it's, you know, when you talk about solving this talent challenge, it's like our profession is perfect. You know, for if, you know, you think about the millennials and the biggest, you know, generation kind of going through our firms right now, and we're set up to give them what they want. Mm-hmm. And we just need to take advantage of that. So I think it also, a big area that's important, you know, not only to millennials, but especially the millennials, is feeling like they have a sense of purpose and that what they do matters. And I think that the work that we do does matter a whole heck of a lot. And encouraging everyone, we did a tell your story. And we put a challenge out there. We wanted to get 10,000 stories. And we got 40,000 stories because it wasn't just the millennials. It was, you know, everybody wanting to say, here's why what I do matters. And it's sometimes not how much you're paying them. It's like, it's not the benefits. It's, they want to make a difference.
So just to maybe pull this together and ask of you all, so this question comes up all the time, and maybe just to flip it, I think the message to the young folks that you're helping to build and shape and mold to deal with some of these challenges that we talked about coming out of the world, there's literally no other better place to come to than the professional services firms, because this is literally in the forefront of our minds. We have leading edge performance systems, leading edge purpose and focus in society, corporate responsibility, trading, benefits, investment in each other, investment in technology, because we have to. And one of the things that amazes me is as I travel around the country and the world and talk to CEOs, they're actually, like, we look in the mirror and say, we stink, we can do better and better. The reality is we're miles ahead of where corporate America is and the rest of the corporate world is. And most CEOs want to know from us, what are you doing to deal with it? And frankly, they're where we were 6 years ago, 5 years ago. So I think the message to the students on campus has got to be, if you want somebody who's really in tune with what your needs are, and you heard our perspective on their collective needs, there's no better place to go than the firms at this point, because they are very much in tune with that. And I have to tell you, I was shocked with one of the leading tech companies about a year ago when I was sitting with their CEO, and they're sitting there begging us for information what they're doing around flexibility, around purpose, around performance management, and we actually thought they were going to be the best in the world at it. So the reality is the firms are in great shape relative to where the rest of the world is, and it's a great opportunity for us to take what you're building and then shape even further. So maybe what I'll do is I'll go one more question to the panel, and then I'll throw it to Q&A. So if you have a question, maybe raise your hand and we'll get you the mic. But Cathy, maybe I'll start with you on this one. So we talked a little bit earlier about international students on campus, and the reality is we are running global businesses in some way, shape, or form as part of network firms. How do we think about globalization in the terms of recruiting talent, both how they should think about our firms and the opportunities for them out there?
Yeah, if you look at any university today, almost every student seems to do some kind of international semester abroad, year abroad, and many want to continue that experience depending where they go and what their experience was. But usually what's ironic is at the university level, they have the greatest semester of their lives, then they come to us, and then, you know, usually we wait too long to give them an opportunity to do a global assignment. And when we do, they're kind of out of sight, out of mind, and we don't do a great job of repatriating them back to our firm here in the US. So a lot in that one statement to think about as we think about these opportunities and the way our clients obviously have evolved and globalized. But I feel like this is another area that we've been talking about for 10 years, and we still haven't figured out how to get the right people deployed around the globe to drive consistency in the way we deliver our service to our clients. And I know that's something our regulators are very, very interested in, how we're doing on that, and really to drive that diversity around the globe, both inbound and outbound. And so I think we need to take the skill sets that we, you know, that you all have helped develop at the university level into our firms and really maximize their potential across the globe. We're not even close to where we need to be. The numbers aren't there. Quite frankly, I don't know where the millennials actually stand on this, because I don't feel like there's been an increase in demand of people knocking on our door saying, I wanna go do this, I wanna go serve this client. We usually have to ask and then kind of put them through our expatriate program. So this is something I think that is certainly something we all need to look at. And I think the inbound stuff is even more interesting to me, as to get people to come in and work with our teams. And they have to come work with our teams on the ground with our clients to get the most out of the experience. Right. Anybody else have a view?
Yeah, with regards to the demand, I've seen the same thing. We have, you know, longer term secondments that we send folks on, or 18 months. What has been the most popular is we have a three month
shorter
assignments
term, yes.
Where they want to go. We you know, if you're on Coca-Cola, you go over to over to Holland and you get to work on Coca-Cola with that team, or boom, boom, and that's what they want to do. They want to have the three monthers, and that's they really value those.
Right.
Quick and in and out versus that commitment. I mean, I moved to Germany for 3 years. I mean, that's a move, right? You're moving. You're 3 months, you get in, you get out. But they really do get a great taste for what it's like to do business. Because there's one thing about living, but when you got to do business and you have to, there's another language being spoken, all that, it does create a real opportunity. But, we try to think of all those things that we can do for them, because they, you know, it is important for them to see what it is like to be in other parts of the world.
So just to build something off something Cathy and Caroline said, most of the folks you're educating are already having international experience. In fact, the numbers are staggering. You think of over 70% of the people we bring in at PwC have had some type of international experience. I think the message is, be again, no better place but to continue that desire. When you look at the global networks we're all a part of, it gives these young folks a chance to continue that desire to learn more about different cultures, to see different parts of the world, to learn different languages, and to have an impact not only in the US but outside the world. So it's a great place to come to continue that career. So we have a question here.
A number of my students, when they're thinking about talking with firms, they are interested in going to London. And my guess is that probably from a career perspective, it would be better for them to start investigating some other areas of the world. What would your advice be for me to give students when they're talking to you about their aspirations for international assignments?
It's a great question, because I have a daughter who just said that to me. I want to go to London, because I brought her to London with me. And I said, maybe post-Brexit, she won't want to be in London. I don't know. But it's this is just more of a personal answer to your question. I would like her to be immersed in a culture and a language that's different from here. And London is different from here, I understand. But, you know, I think the experience she could get being immersed in a different culture could be enormously helpful to whoever she goes to work for one day. So that's I just make it personal, and that's how I would answer that question is, you know, you want to get, I know my niece who had gone to Vanderbilt went to Barcelona and had this amazing experience, became fluent in Spanish, got her job back here in the U.S. because she was fluent in Spanish at that point, and it really, you know, kind of jump-started her career. And really gave her, you know, a real purpose at having done it in a different culture. But it's a tough, because everyone does want to go to London. Now my daughter told me Australia is on her list too.
And personally, I mentioned that I was in Germany for 3 years on an assignment, and we purposely wanted to go someplace that didn't speak the language. And what you can tell your students is, truly, their English is spoken just about everywhere, and you can get around, you can survive. It may take you 6 months to get cable in your home, but that's a whole other story. But you can survive.
They don't watch TV; they stream it on their iPads.
So. But what you can do. So it does make it a little more uncomfortable. But the value you get of then learning another language, why if you're going to go do it, why not get that extra benefit of going to some place where you may be fluent by the end of it, but you know, you at least you're going to be able to, you know, cobble your way through it. I think not knowing the language is probably the most exciting part of doing an international assignment.
I was just going to add that I think where you go will sort of change as the business climate changes as well. And I think tying it to, so what are the economic realities of the moment for students to be thinking about? And, you know, if you look at, so where's the, you know, biggest growth going to be? You know, right now it's India. You know, that would be a very different experience for someone, or China. And so I think not doing just sort of the easy, comfortable thing, but doing something that takes you out of your comfort zone a little bit and can enhance your career, kind of tying it back to where you know, not just what's going to be the most fun place that I can go to all these great European, you know, cities, but, you know, what's going to be the thing that's going to give me something different than, you know, all of the other thousands of new hires at a firm. So I'd consider that as well.
I did learn a little fun fact from my daughter. She said, Mom, at a place like Penn State or big football programs, you do your semester overseas in the spring because they want to be there for football season. Now she goes to Villanova, she says, we do it in the fall so we can be there for basketball season. So the timing of this is even important to these digital natives.
So just one more comment on that. So the advice I would give to students who are asking your opinion is, I'd tell them, first of all, when you look at the professional service firm, they have the ability to do it all. Because the reality is, the follow the trends. And right now, the short-term trend is the single biggest country for inbound investment is the United States. So notwithstanding all of our challenges, it's the country that across the globe CEOs have the most confidence investing in is the United States. After that is Europe. So notwithstanding all of their challenges, Europe. The emerging markets over the last 3 years have waned. Now, long-term, we expect that to continue. But the reality is they come to any of these firms, we have clients right now who are investing big time in Europe, big time in the United States, and we're going to need people. I was over in London just a few weeks ago. I met with our expats. There were over 275 expats at an informal breakfast just to catch up. Now, over time, I do expect that to shift, but not in the near term. So the reality is, if their desire is to go to somewhere a little safer and a little more familiar, the firms have needs in London because business is investing in London. The reality is business is also investing for the long term, and they're investing in other areas. Question is, how far out of their comfort zone do they want to step? And that's different for everybody, which makes it more attractive to be at one of these firms, because the reality is you need all different types. It's not like we only need India, only need Indonesia, we need it all. And so the great place about coming here is they can choose what's right for them. Other questions? Yep, over here.
Thanks, Tim. Tim, I'd just like to come back to Michelle's question earlier about attracting minority talent into the industry. And this is for everybody on the panel. Is there an opportunity for us as an industry working with academia to really educate the high school community of minority children about our profession, about what's good about it, so that when they get to university, it's top of mind? And in that effort, you know, I think of an organization I sit on the board of called Young People's Chorus of New York City, which takes young people from the South Bronx and Central Park South at the age of 7, and they perform together in this international chorus group that's been internationally recognized by the president and others for the great work they do in bringing different cultures together. I'm an immigrant myself, and I joined the board of this organization because I came to New York because I felt it was a great place, center of the world in a sense, where it brings everybody together. And this organization epitomized what I'm about. And I would think, as I was listening to you all talk about this, I said there's an opportunity for me to talk to this community of 1,200 kids yep. about our profession so that when they go to university, it's top of mind. But the bigger question is there a broader opportunity for us as a firm to work, and as an industry group, to work together and target organizations like this? And just a note on this group, 100% of their kids go on to four-year colleges. So they've had great success. And they're, you know, so you're targeting a group of highly motivated, educated young people from minority communities. I'd like to get your perspective on that, please.
Yeah, it's a great story. And I think we could all replicate that story probably, you know, 5 to 10 times. There's a lot of organizations, particularly in the big cities. I know there's the Opportunity Network and Harlem YMCA, and these are all typically sponsoring underrepresented minority scholarships to four-year college programs. The issue I see is we all spread it like peanut butter, and how do we really make an impact to scale it at a higher level so that we get this pipeline? So you've got 1,000, we've got 1,000, you guys all have, you know, how do we actually band together and really use our power of scale and our power of the number of employees we ultimately hire to help get this pipeline driven through the university level and to pick accounting and to, you know, then want to be certified and do the fifth year, et cetera. So, I mean, those are all the challenges we're faced with. We'd love ideas like yours where we could have more of an impact at scale. Our issue is, we're doing it very piecemeal. We've got some great successes. We have some that aren't so successful. How do we do that at scale is our issue.
Yeah, I think there's a huge opportunity to educate. Somebody made the comment earlier that particularly for high school students, most of them know what teachers, doctors, and nurses do, but probably don't have a good idea of what most other professionals do and what our jobs are about day to day. I know coming out of college, you know, what I did day to day was quite a bit different than really what I thought it might be, in a good way. And so I do think that there's an opportunity to educate young people on what this profession's all about and what it's all about. I mean, we're not green eye shades and calculators. You know, we interact, we collaborate, and it's very dynamic, very innovative, and I think there's a huge opportunity to educate in that area.
Okay, this question back here.
So just to go back to the previous comment on getting into high schools, what we find is that probably less than 1% of guidance counselors know anything about business careers, mm-hmm. right? And so you're not going to be able to get the message out through them necessarily unless you educate them. Also, parents are an extremely important constituency group. So you can't just go straight to the students. We have to find a way to get to the parents as well. And then there's one more impediment based on the way that universities are organized oftentimes, is that as a professor in the Kelly School of Business, I have a difficulty going to a high school and promoting the business school because Indiana University says you cannot be pushing a program. Right. We want them to come to IU, but by you doing this, you're circumventing the rest of the school. So this is saying, this is just a way of saying we need you to do this for us because I can't lead this. I can't go into the high schools without going sideways with the president of the university. So, and one other suggestion is that this type of a arrangement needs to be done at the local office level, right? So what's going to have to happen is that you can have a program at the central, you know, at the central firm level or at the CAQ level, but ultimately to impact people going to Indiana University potentially, it's got to be implemented at the Indianapolis office level, at the Chicago office level, and working across firms in making this happen. And that's just a suggestion.
I completely agree with that, and because this is hand-to-hand combat, and we, it can't, you know, we do junior achievement, we do NAF, we do all of these things, and it's not helping. And so it requires every single person in our firms to have the goal to make it happen. And it will happen on the ground where I say, okay, what am I doing personally to tell the story, to attract, to recruit, to ensure that that student is getting into college, that they know about business and that I'm helping them be successful. And then hopefully, ultimately, they're at one of our firms or at least in the profession somewhere. And so it goes back to, it's not just your diversity group that's gonna make this happen. It's gonna take everybody getting involved. And when you think about that, you know, we have thousands of partners at our firms. I mean, if each partner, right, you know, did their, you know, one person, it's huge.
But I agree with your parent comment. I think that it's a huge untapped resource for us are the parents of any student, and let alone the underrepresented minority population, who don't understand the profession, don't know the opportunities, don't maybe see us in kind of the public eye of how we're trying to promote the profession, haven't followed our hashtag auditor pride, proud social media blitz. So I do think there has to be something, and I think the parent thing is a huge opportunity for us.
And just as a follow-on, so what's happening is that, you know, on our campuses, to delicately put it maybe, is that the firms are engaging in hand-to-hand combat against each other, right, and trying to get the very best. And so, you know, changing that culture to actually working together to further the profession, I think that would be a great step forward, especially getting it to in front of the parents and in front of the high school students.
You know what's really wonderful is the energy around this that I'm hearing even today, right? I mean, think about the number of questions and how many questions are around this topic. And so it's clear to me sitting here is just, this isn't something that we can just say we do need to do it. We need to continue the efforts that we have in working with all the universities to do this. I think this is, it's actually making me feel good about it. We need to get there, but that there's a lot of energy that we need.
Yeah, so let me see if there's, we probably have time for one more question. Right here.
Yeah, just following up, Ira Solomon from Tulane University, just following up on the last couple of comments, you know, there is a very successful model already present on university campuses, and that's the football and basketball coaches who go do visits in individual homes and often connect through the parents, or at least with the parents, and then in turn with the prospective student athlete in that case. But there's a model that's very, very successful in a relative sense that somebody mentioned that there are thousands of partners. If each one went down that kind of a path, the outcomes may be greatly improved.
Good.
Thanks,
idea.
Sarah.
Yep, good idea.
Okay, see if there's one more. All right, so let me do this before I bring this to a close. So folks, for you, each of you, 15 to 30 seconds, an ask of this group as they interact with students. So Jeff, maybe I'll ask you first.
I think the ask is continue to do some of the things that Chris was talking about and John as well, as far as continuing to educate the students on the things that are coming down the pike for us. the data analytics, the technology, some of those areas.
I would just say that, you know, we've talked a lot about a lot of issues around talent, and the world is changing so fast that we can't do this in isolation. So, and I think the dialogue today has proven that. So I guess my ask would be, where you see the opportunity, reach out to us and engage with us, because I think our objectives are very similar, and working together, I think we'll have better results.
Carolyn?
Yeah, you know, we have no desire to have cookie cutter programs at every school. We all know that you all have your programs are going to be all different, but then partnering with us to just figure out within the context of what you have, how do we help you move things forward? So we can be very helpful to you if we partner in a real way in the context of what your particular university has to deal with.
And I just say, help us change the dialogue that this from bean counter to innovative professional services firm, because we're all investing heavily in technologies, tools, and talent around innovation. Help us change the dialogue to this is an innovative profession that you want to be part of.
Great. And I would just say, first of all, thank you for everything that you're doing, and continue to push us. And when you interact with young folks who want to really make a difference and make an impact, push them to this profession with enthusiasm, because the glass is way, way more half full than it is empty with everything that's out there. So with that, we're going to wrap it up. We're going to be back here at 1:30, right, Cindy? Do you need to say something? You want to say, make sure people are back at 1:30.
That is, and I was also, well, right. First of all, I was going to thank the panel. Yeah. I want to thank John and Chris for... talking to us about innovation in the classroom. And of course, I want to thank our panel, Jeff, Lynn, Carolyn, Cathy, and Tim. You guys have given us a lot to think about. Tim, you said that we weren't going to have solutions. I think that's right, but you did crystallize a lot of things that we can be doing at the CAQ through our talent initiative and things that the firms and the academics can do. So you've given us a lot of food for thought. So again, thank you.
Thanks.